Greetings, peeps of the interwebs. Jake here, and not joining me is my normal team of podcasters, because our schedules aren't aligning, so instead, I decided to bring in my good friend Tyler McLaughlin. Say hello to the interwebs.
Now everyone knows my name. Thanks a lot.
Yes, so track this man down on Facebook, find out where he lives, and... It, depending on his point of view in this trailer, send him hate, or if you agree with him, then send him lots of love and affection, because, you know.
Yes.
And, so, if you can't tell by whatever title I'll end up titling this, this is a trailer analysis on Batman, the most recent Batman v Superman trailer. So.
I would like just to point out, if the only way I can imagine you cannot read the title is, one, you're blind, or two, you can't read, but if you're blind... Why the hell are you watching this in the first place?
Yeah, unless you just enjoy audio, and you just randomly like going on YouTube and clicking videos, you're like, what's this random video about? Then I apologize if I've offended you. But anyways, so, Tyler, let's start off with you. What were your first, impression with this most recent trailer?
My first impression was, where to begin? Summarize it one sentence. Where to begin?
Which, you know, that's usually not a good sign when you get done watching a trailer or even a movie, and then like afterwards you're kind of like, oh man, a lot to digest here. Now sometimes that's a good thing because that means either one, you were just overwhelmed by like all the greatness and you're like, oh, where to start with the greatness, or. We talked about this a couple days ago, like, our opinions on the trailer, and we share the same opinion in, after the trailer, I was like, okay,
really when we say where to begin, it's really, there's a bit of good, but there's also a bit of bad, but either way, there's so much stuff we have to discuss and
yeah,
point out.
Like, okay, let's start off with the beginning of the trailer, which I really enjoyed, like, that first part of the trailer, when Clark Kent and Bruce Wayne, it looks like they're at some kind of, like, social event that Lex Luthor's throwing, and you see, you know, Bruce Wayne get out of his car, and Clark, you know, he's kind of greeting him, and he's kind of like, hey, you know, what are your thoughts on the Bat Vigilante in Gotham? And, you know, he's basically like they're having this really nice dialogue, and he's kind of like, well, you know, I don't really like the fact that you're writing all these puff pieces on like this alien who thinks he's like a hero and all that stuff. And, you know, he's just like, maybe it's just the Gotham in me, but, you know, we don't really care too much for, you know, crazy people dressing up as clowns, you know, making a Joker reference, but also... In my opinion, like, in that, the way Bruce was looking at Clark, I'm pretty sure he knows that Clark is Superman. And I think Clark, at that moment, realizes he knows. So it's kind of like this, that, I think that's going to be one of the first conversations where, like, I'm pretty sure that's the first time they meet. I think that's what sets the tension for the drama to come throughout the film. What'd you think about that first part of the trailer?
For me, I could definitely see that because of it, probably throughout the first half of the film, also depending on how long the film is, which, judging by other Marvel... call it a new series! by other, superhero films, I would probably have to say that the film's gonna probably be maybe 2.5 hours. So,
yeah.
Judging by that first bit, something tells me... The first, say, hour, possibly half, maybe the whole film, we don't know, it's not out yet.
Yeah.
That there's definitely going to be a lot of tension between the two, a lot of build-up, and that's what that scene showed between the
oh,
two,
yeah.
Is a build-up.
Like, it was almost palpable, and, you know, again, like, there were a lot of things I didn't like about this trailer, but that I absolutely loved, just the tension between those two and, like, that dialogue, I thought was really engaging. It was, like, it wasn't anything, like, elaborate where they were, like, yeah, there's, like, witty banter going back and forth. It was just kind of like, you know, again, this is all speculation. But judging from that first bit of the trailer, I'm positive at that point they both figure out who each other are, and so then it's kind of like... But then, of course, that's when, And he, you know, that's what I liked about it. And then that's when Lex Luthor comes in, played by good old Jesse Eisenberg.
Played by Jesse Eisenberg.
Yeah. And then that's when the trailer starts to go downhill. And because, you know, he's kind of like, oh, boys, good old Bruce Wayne and Clark Kent. This kind of like wacky, quirky character. And I know, like, a lot of people are defending his portrayal of Lex Luthor. They're kind of like, well, okay, this is how he's, like, acting in public, to kind of make himself seem kind of whimsical and kind of carefree and just, like, a, you know, goofy, possibly likable guy. And then, in the, you know, when he's not in the public guy, that's when he's kind of all mad scientist sociopath, which, I you know, that's true. I honestly believe that's true, but I still feel like if you're trying to seem even normal, like, in social things, I just feel like Lex Luthor would carry himself not as, like, this kind of wacky, goofy guy that's, like, making jokes. Like, when he shakes Clark's hand, he's kind of like, oh, what a grip this guy, wouldn't want to pick a fight with him, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, that they're gonna fight later on in the film. It's kind of like, I really hope that, like, that joke was intentionally meant to be, like, kind of cheesy and lame. So, yeah, for me, that's when the trailer starts to kind of go downhill. And again, I get their defense for it, but I don't like it. That's not how I envision Lex Luthor at all. And,
yes, and also, sorry not to cut you off, but this is also another subject I was going back. I was talking to you actually just about a few days ago, is a lot of people seem to judge, especially now, hit or miss, because like I said, some people defending him.
Yeah.
As a lot of people judge, it's that we have not had a good Lex Luthor, because a lot of people say Gene Hackman was bad from the original four Superman. Mm-hmm. Some people say Kevin Spacey was bad. I don't even know if there's another person who portrayed Lex Luthor.
But not in like a film. Like, there's, you know, been, because there's the Superman,
Smallville?
There's Smallville. There was the Lois and Clark show, which it's been ages since I saw that, so I actually don't recall if Lex Luthor was in it. I'm pretty sure he was, but I don't remember what he was like. And then I believe there was an old Superman show from, like, the 40s or 50s, maybe?
Yeah, I think it was in the 50s. It was in black and white and all that.
Yeah. Again, it's been a long time since I've seen, like, the original Superman movies with Christopher Reeve. From what I recall, I thought Gene Hackman was good, and I like Kevin Spacey. I thought he was a really good...
Yeah, no, he's a fantastic actor, but also another thing I've noticed, it seems like each of them brings a unique pros, because wasn't Kevin Spacey, like, completely bald or some shit like that in the movie?
Yeah, he was like, completely bald from the start, which... That's just a staple of Lex Luthor,
Okay, well, that's kind of interesting, because looking at Jesse Eisenberg, he kind of reminds me of my hair I had back in high school.
Well, like, there is some speculation, like, some people are saying that he's already gone bald, and he, like, he wears the wig, like, in public, because he's kind of like
a toupee, yeah.
Yeah, like a toupee, because, you know, he's, I don't know, I guess maybe self-conscious, or just, I don't know, but, like, it clearly looked like a wig, or toupee, because that's the technical term for it, for men.
Yes.
It's clearly a toupee, not just in terms of, like, it's obviously a toupee because, you know, he had to shave his head for the film, but, like, I'm pretty sure that's, like, an actual toupee in the film, if that makes any sense.
But also another point I want to point out, and another reason why people might criticizing him, is because out of all the people to portray him, Lex Luthor specifically, Jesse Eisenberg, as far as I can tell, is the youngest, because both Hackman and Spacey, they were well into their 40s.
Yeah.
I want to say Jesse Eisenberg's, like,
he's, I think, like,
very early 30s.
Yeah, like, I think he's the same age as Henry Cavill. I think they're, like, there's only, like, a month or two between those two. So they're, like, you know, early 30s, like, 33, 34, something like that. But, like, also, I'm not 100% sure, but I've heard that Jesse Eisenberg's character is technically Lex Luthor Jr., so he's kind of a different character from, like, the Lex Luthor, but it's still, I don't know, it's, I don't know, for me, it's like, okay, either, if you're gonna establish, like, this whole universe and you're essentially bringing out the big guns in this movie and having, like, the big trio of the DC universe, you know, comics and all that, Wonder Woman, Batman, Superman, you're bringing a big bad Doomsday, why not just have
We'll get more on to Doomsday later.
Yeah, we'll get into that later. Like, why not just bring in the Lex Luthor, not, like, Lex Luthor Jr.? Because I feel like, I mean, yeah, they could easily be like, you know, this is Lex Luthor Jr., and maybe, you know, the Lex Luthor is the big bad in, like, a future solo Superman movie. Which, you know, that's, I would just prefer, like, if it was Lex Luthor, especially if it was Bryan Cranston, because the man said, after, like, shortly after he wrapped up Breaking Bad, he was like, yeah, I'll play Lex Luthor if, you know, Warner Brothers asks me. That's one of those.
Also, that's kind of a problem because, like I said, there's really a mix of the two, because the problem is, Jesse Eisenberg, some people say he's too young, after all, which, by the way, you are right, him and Henry Cavill, they're both 32, so okay, fairly yeah. young. But also the problem is, some people might look and say Crime Boss is bad because he's too old to play Lex Luthor, so it's really a toss-up, so should they maybe take some guy in his 40s, or...
Well, no, like, I don't think age is so much a big deal. I mean, because I think it depends on the comic. Like, I think in some cases, Lex Luthor and Superman are about the same age. I think sometimes Lex is a little bit older. He might be a little younger.
Yeah, that's true. It's the same with Batman. Like, there was, I forget what it's called. You probably know it, but there's a comic book series where I think Bruce Wayne's, like, in his late 60s.
The Dark Knight Returns by Frank Miller.
Yes,
that's
what it is.
But yeah, usually, like, in the comics, you know, aside from, like, Elseworlds stories like that, Bruce Wayne is perpetually, like, 35 years old. I think about the same for, like, all their major, you know, DC characters. Like, they're all, like, you know, in their early to mid-30s. And so, like, you know, in terms of, like, the age of, like, Henry and Jesse Eisenberg, yeah, that's about a good age. And especially if you're trying to build your own cinematic universe that could last, say, 10 years tops. You know, you wanna have actors who are about, you know, about that age. That way, you know, in 10 years' time, they're still in their early 40s, and they still can probably play the roles and be in good shape and all that. But I don't know. Like, I've never been sold on Jesse Eisenberg as Lex Luthor. Like, Warner Brothers has been really weird with their casting. I've mentioned it before on this channel.
Ben Affleck.
Yeah, like, cause okay, here's
more on him later.
Here is my initial reaction, like, because I know Man of Steel was very divided. I personally loved the film. I thought it was really good. It was Superman on the right scale.
I heavily agree, too.
And so, like, after Man of Steel, I was like, oh, wow, that's, yes, okay, that's a good Superman movie. That's Superman on the right scale. And I was kind of like, well, how are they going to top that, though? Like, how is a future Superman movie going to top that? And this was before they announced they were going to do, like, the whole cinematic universe thing. And then, like, a coworker of mine was kind of like, oh, well, Batman's gonna be in it. How he knew this, like, before they officially confirmed it, I don't know. But then I was just like, what?
Maybe a hunch.
Yeah, it might have been a hunch, or maybe it was one of those, like, rumors that, you know, was heavily rumored that, like, one of those rumors where everyone knows that it's true, but just there wasn't, like, an actual, like, official confirmation yet. So when I heard Batman was gonna be in it, I was like, alright, I'm sold. Then they cast Ben Affleck, and I was like, nope, not sold anymore. But then, I was like, well, okay, like, Ben Affleck, he's changed completely from, like, the Daredevil movie that was not very good, and...
Yes, or let alone a lot of movies, because...
Yeah, a lot of his 90s movies,
that's
and...
That's the big... Or, almost early 2000s, but still...
Or, you know, 90s and early 2000s,
that's
yeah.
That's definitely my first thought was, is I was very skeptical, and at first, I agree with a lot of people, I was like... I don't think he'll pull it, because he's had good movies. He's had Good Will Hunting, he's had The Town, he's had Gone Girl, but then he's had some other fallouts, like the Daredevil movie you mentioned. He did that god-awful movie, Geely.
Yeah.
He did some other weird movie with, I had it pulled up, it was like Jersey Girl or some shit, I don't remember. But, so he's really had a hit-and-miss run.
I'd say more, like, up until, like, The Town... Ben Affleck, for me, like, I was never like, oh, he's a terrible actor. He was just Ben Affleck in every movie. Like, he doesn't ruin the film, he's just Ben Affleck. You know, it's like, yeah, he's fine. But then
yeah,
after I saw The Town...
next to his real-life best friend,
Matt Damon. Yeah, when Matt Damon's in a movie, like, he always excels. Even if the movie isn't that great, he's always, you know, Matt Damon's gonna, he's gonna deliver a good performance. But then after I saw The Town, which he co-wrote, directed, produced, and starred in, I was like... Okay, Affleck, all right. You're kind of like realizing you've made a lot of mistakes and just being in crappy movies, taking a quick paycheck. You're getting more creative now. Like, he's getting hands-on in the film industry. He's not
Yes, and in
just.
fact, because that film, everyone forgot about the dreaded Geely movie. Like, literally, everyone was like, "All right, we side with you. Fuck that movie. We're with you now."
Yeah, and I think that was like the film that like gained him a lot of respect for just
Yes,
people in
that
general.
was his comeback,
Yeah.
because for especially in the very early 2000s, he didn't have that good roles. And then as the turn of the 2010s, that's where he then started picking things up. And
Yeah.
ever since then, he's been doing pretty well with The Town,
Argo,
Argo,
Gone Girl.
Gone Girl, and
Like,
then there's a few more upcoming movies. Well, obviously Batman vs Superman, but I think there's another film. I don't remember.
those are probably like his three big like I guess bigger like three biggest films that like stood out to audiences, critics, where they're kind of like, whoa, what, where is this coming from? Ben Affleck's like stepping out of the shadows, and turns out he's a really good director and like writer and producer and actor and all that stuff. So you know, I was warming up to Ben Affleck as Bruce Wayne Batman. So like, okay, you know what? I don't hate it now. And then you know, they cast Jesse Eisenberg. Like, it's like a like my whole opinions on the Batman versus Superman movie has been a roller coaster. I was excited, and then Ben Affleck, I was like, no. And then I was like, I'm warming up to Ben Affleck, going up the hill. Jesse Eisenberg going down, and then, but overall, I was like, okay, whatever. Let's just hope they've got a very specific plan. And then I saw that first Batman versus Superman trailer, the one they released at Comic-Con, swept all my like apprehension away. I was like, I'm sold. I want to see this movie right now. Like, I was pumped. I rewatched that trailer like probably three times after like I first watched it. I was just like, oh yeah. I was like, replay, replay, replay. But then after,
You and that Star Wars trailer.
yes, and the Star Wars trailer. I've rewatched those so many times. But after, like when I heard that they were dropping the trailer on Jimmy Kimmel, I was kind of like, oh cool. Like, not that they needed to drop another trailer, because I thought that first one was perfect. It showed you enough about the film to get you pumped. But it didn't ruin anything. But then this one came out, and so I was like, okay, cool. Hopefully it'll be just as good as the other one. And again, started off strong, and then it just kept going downhill. And I was just after the trailer was done, I was like, ooh, okay, now I'm apprehensive again. Like, my excitement, like, I'm still gonna go see the movie. I'm looking forward to it. I'm not trying to knock the
Yeah, same here.
movie.
I plan to see it March is when it comes out.
Yeah, like March.
I'm probably not gonna go see it opening weekend, but I definitely do want to go see it in theaters. That's for damn
I'm
sure.
definitely gonna see it opening weekend. Like again, I'm not trying to sound like a DC hater. I'm not trying to knock the movie. I'm just saying this is all based on the trailer. The movie could blow my mind, and you know, I'll regret every negative thing I said about the movie, if it turns out to be as good as I hope it is. But as again, basing on the trailer, I'm back to like apprehensive, to where I'm kind of like, I don't know. This movie could either be like really great and awesome, or it'll be one of those movies where it's fun, like it's entertaining. You get to see like Batman and Superman fight, but like it just doesn't deliver. Like, it just seems like Warner Brothers and DC just like really rushed and shoehorned everything in there. They're like, okay, we need to catch up to Marvel. Shove everything in there at once. Justice League in your face. And that kind of leads into my biggest issue with this trailer is Doomsday. Like, okay, like Doomsday and Wonder Woman, they reveal those two, which Wonder Woman was in the first trailer but very briefly. And so you're kind of like, which again, a lot of people defended this trailer, which yeah, I'm not disagreeing with them, like I get it, where they're kind of like, well, what, how did it reveal too much? Like, we all knew that Wonder Woman was going to be in the movie. We all knew that you know, they would all team up, and we all knew that Doomsday was going to be with them in the movie. It's like, yes, that's true, but it's the way they cut this trailer to where, you know, Batman and Superman, they're fighting each other, because it is Batman v Superman. Dawn of Justice is the lower headline. So it's like, yes, we all know that, you know, they're gonna team up, and this is the beginning of the Justice League. I get that, but this is a Batman Superman movie first and foremost. So when Doomsday shows up, who looks terrible, by the way, like, he just looks like a... He looks like a generic CGI monster that is the love child of the Ninja Turtles from the Michael Bay Ninja Turtle movie and the Thing from the shitty Fantastic Four movie. Like, they just had a baby, and that's what this monster looks like.
Yes, as for what my comparison was, it looked like you took the Charger from Left 4 Dead 2 and gave it a bunch of steroids and then inject it with cerebral palsy, and that's what it looks like.
Yeah. And again, people are defending it. It's like, well, you know, Doomsday evolves, so this is like his first stage.
He's not a Pokemon.
That's fine too. But again, if you're going to reveal the big bad of the film, show him, like, you know, again, if he does like evolve and like get bigger and stronger like he does in the comics, then show him in his final stage. So that way, if you're gonna show the final, like, the big bad of the movie, I'm at least gonna be impressed with the way he looks and be like, all right, okay, it's Doomsday, but he looks badass, instead of like, ugh, that's Doomsday? Come on. And then, like, they essentially ruined the third act for me. Because, like, I knew that, like, the fight between the big bad, you know, Doomsday would come into the third act. I knew that. But they basically ruined it, because, you know,
But also another speculation is, especially, like I said, the way the last minute, 30 seconds, however long, I don't remember exactly how deep that was into the trailer, but... Because of that, it might also lead to the speculation that he may show up even much earlier in the film. In fact, and if that's the case, then there's probably going to be barely any fighting of the actual title, because I bet a lot of people to go see it to see Batman and Superman fight.
Yeah, and...
Now you throw in this thing in, it might actually cut out the time you actually get to see these two beloved DC characters fight it out. That's what everyone wants to go see. Like,
yeah.
even people like me who have not read the comic books, but are...
Yeah, like, full disclosure, like, Tyler does not read comics.
Absolutely kill each other.
Yeah. Like, Tyler's just a fan of cinema. He doesn't read comics. He likes the movies, I assume.
I've looked into them a bit, but also I just have not found the time with other things. But, yeah. Anyways, back to what I was saying is... Definitely, that's the thing we want to see. But then, especially then, you throw in Wonder Woman saving their asses, and then them all lined up, looking at Doomsday. Now you believe it's like, wait, how much is it either actually be fighting?
And here's like,
where did it come in? And that's where it brings up so many questions. And then you have to wonder, what's it gonna do? Because also another big issue is how long is the film gonna be? Because if it's say 2.5 hours, normal superhero film, then it might be okay. But if it's
under two hours, this movie's gonna be a convoluted, jumbled mess.
Yes, it absolutely will be. So it's now, and another thing, because they still got say another 5 months, maybe four. About 4 months, because it comes out in March.
Yeah.
Because now you have to wonder is if they're done, if they're not done filming. Maybe now they can look at their mistakes and say, alright, let's correct this and throw them off. But like, if they are done filming, now a lot of people kind of know what they're going to see when they go into see this film.
I'd say they're for sure done filming. However, you know, a lot of people assume that, like, once a movie is done, that, like, it just gets shipped out to the theaters, which that is the case for some movies, but, like, there are some instances where, like, a movie, like, they're still, like, tweaking, like, tweaking parts of the movie, like, probably more or less, like, CGI effects and all that stuff, probably 2 weeks until, like, the release of that film. So I'd say, and I hope, that, like, after the... Because, again, the trailer seems to be very divided. Half the people loved it. The other half are, like, me and you, where we're kind of like, ugh. So hopefully Warner Brothers are like, okay, so people don't like Doomsday. Let's tweak that a little bit, and then maybe when we see, like, another trailer... so I think they're supposed to release either the same trailer or another trailer during the Force Awakens movie. Hopefully they'll tweak it, and Doomsday will look better. So yeah, they still have time to, like, edit some things and tweak a little bit, but yeah, I'd say for sure they're done filming, but just make Doomsday look better, please. I know that's...
Yes, this is the 21st century, and also remember, this is Zack Snyder. A lot of his films have good effects, like Watchmen, 300, Man of Steel,
like, people
any
can,
films you could think of that he did.
People can say what they want about, like, him as a director, but his visuals are good. Like, even that movie Sucker Punch, which sucked, it had good visuals. I'll give it that. But I did not like that movie at all. But overall, he does have a decent track record. You know, again, Watchmen, I thought was fantastic. Pretty close to the source material.
Yeah, indeed it was.
I like Man of Steel.
Actually, that's the thing that a lot of people praise Zack Snyder, and or I guess a lot of Frank Miller's things, because this goes along with Sin City, is he likes to be as accurate as he can to source material. That's what people said about both Sin City and 300.
Yeah.
They were not a adaptation. They were a direct translation. And I've read a few of the graphic novels. Yes, I read graphic novels, not comic books.
That's pretty much...
if you want to, fan people.
Pretty much but the same thing, really.
Literally, that's what it is. I've read a few of the Sin City graphic novels, and they were spot-on translations from the page to the screen.
Yeah, like, he is really good at that. Like, almost like... you could almost be, like, reading the graphic novel as you're watching the film and be like, oh, damn, this is almost verbatim.
Mm-hmm. But also, another thing you have to remember with the Batman vs. Superman film is that it's also being... I can't remember if he's the producer or... he might be executive, but Christopher Nolan himself is also working on this film. He did the same thing with Man of Steel.
I know he was a producer on Man of Steel, but I don't think Nolan's involved in Batman vs. Superman.
I think he is. Let me double-check my sources while you're talking.
Okay, but yeah, like, I guess back to, like, the scene where you see, like, you know, Wonder Woman show up is... it's like, okay, by all means, show Wonder Woman, but don't show her, like, coming in to save the day, because now we know... like, okay, sure, like, if they didn't show that scene when we're watching the movie, obviously Doomsday's not gonna, like, vaporize Batman and kill him. But it's still the fact that you're kind of like, oh, well, how is he gonna get out of this situation? And then in the movie, you know, if they hadn't shown that in the trailer... Wonder Woman shows up and saves the day, you're kind of like, yay, cool! Like, it's more impactful, whereas now it's kind of like, oh, well, this is the part where Wonder Woman saves him.
Yes.
That's fine.
And that's the thing is, this trailer is, I guess, to throw all of us off, because that's what some trailers have done, is you see them, you think you know what to expect, but in some cases, it's not what it is. But in this case, something tells me this is actually going to be pretty accurate to what we're going to see in the film. And by the way, Christopher Nolan is executive producing Batman vs. Superman.
Okay, well, I guess that gives me a little bit less apprehension, but still, they really could have cut this trailer better. Like, if they had just left out the last 20, 30 seconds, I would have been... it still wouldn't have been as good as, you know, the first trailer, which was amazing, but it still would have been, I would be less negative about it, because, yeah, again, I get, like, where people are coming from, their mindset and, like, their defense for the trailer, but as a film, like, a film enthusiast, someone who enjoys films, like, I'm not just, like, when I see movies, especially, like, comic movies and stuff like that, I can watch it first as a comic fan, like, I'll be like, yay, Batman, Superman, woo! But I can also, like, distance myself from the comic book reader, the fan of these characters, and just analyze it as a film and be like, okay, well, does this film actually, could it stand alone as a good film? Not just a good superhero film, but, like, could you essentially take this story and change the characters or whatever, like, say, you know... Probably not the best example for Batman versus Superman, but a good example is Captain America Winter Soldier. That's a really good movie because you could essentially, like, tweak that to where it's not like Captain America is just, you know, some other guy, and, you know, the characters just change their names and tweak it a little bit, and then it just becomes a really good spy espionage thriller. And that's what I loved about that movie. It's not only a good superhero movie, it's a good Captain America movie, but it's also a really good spy espionage thriller, and it just so happens Captain America's the lead actor.
There's also a lot of sci-fi advanced technology in it.
Yeah. And that was one thing that I loved about the Christopher Nolan Batman trilogy, is it wasn't really all that comic accurate in terms of, like, some of the stories and stuff like that, but they were grounded in reality. Like, Christopher Nolan wanted to make them, like, believable, like, this could actually happen.
Yes, that's what he's absolutely known. Especially the biggest thing known is very, very well known for is his despise of CGI.
Yes.
A lot of big scenes, some of the big scenes I can think of was the truck flipping scene from The Dark Knight.
He actually flipped
on his own.
Yeah.
In fact, that scene, he actually broke an IMAX camera. And at the time, there were only, I think, like, 4 or 5 in the world. They broke.
Yeah.
But probably the biggest one that blows everyone's mind is the opening scene from The Dark Knight. All of that was spawned on. Literally, he had people blow open a top plane. He had people grapple into the plane. He had people pull him out of the plane. And then he had the plane plummet thousands of feet into the ground. My only question is, where the hell did they film that, that plane had to hit the ground?
Who knows? But, like, that's... That's one thing that I do like about, like, Nolan. Even if, like, there's
and
some
hell,
things...
that's also the reason why his films are so damn expensive. Some
yeah.
of them...
But
almost $300,000.
But I think the payoff works. Like I mean, maybe
it absolutely has. It kills reviews, people, and box office.
And maybe I'm just a fan of like using practicality with CGI. Like, by all means, do that. But the more practical effects you use, the better, in my opinion. Sure, it's maybe a
and
bit
also
more expensive,
it shows you're better,
but it looks better. Granted, there's a lot of really good CGI. Unlike Doomsday, I'm sorry, just, it looks bad, I'm sorry, like, hats off to you if you like the design, or if you like the way it looks. I don't, and again, like I guess the point that I was getting at is, as a filmgoer, I'm observing this trailer, and I'm kind of like, okay, it's got a lot of potential to be good, but it's got so much potential to be bad, because... Again, presumably Doomsday's not going to show up until the third act. Same thing with Wonder Woman. Like, it looks like she'll be in the movie as Diana Prince, but she won't be, like, in her costume as Wonder Woman. So basically, these two characters aren't going to show up until the third act. Aquaman's supposed to be in the movie. Don't know when he's going to show up. Probably towards the end. Flash is also supposed to be in the film, and same with Cyborg. Granted, they'll probably just be, like, cameos, but it's still, like...
Or maybe even a post-credit scene.
Yeah, maybe even a post-credit scene, or
although
whatever.
Although, that's kind of unlikely, because DC, as far as I know, does not do post-credit scenes, let alone Zack Snyder doesn't.
If they do post-credits, I don't think they'll refer to them as post-credits. They'll be like, these are our in-credit... Yeah, whatever. They'll come up with their own term, because that's kind of the Marvel trend, is the post-credit scenes. But, like, they're all supposed to be in this movie as well. Again, probably cameos, maybe, like, very small roles where they have, like, a few lines of dialogue.
They'll just be the Stan Lee DC movie.
Yeah, like, you just see, like, Aquaman, like, rising out of the water watching the whole fight, eating popcorn or something. He's kind of like, yeah, this is really fun. Or, like, you know, Flash is just running so fast, he's just kind of like, whee, this is fun, they don't even see me running around him. And then Cyborg's just, I don't know, chilling, I don't know. But it's just like, you've got all these characters and you've got all this going together, so it's got so much potential to basically be like Spider-Man 3 or Amazing Spider-Man 2, where they had great ideas, a really good concept, where they're building up to something, like, bigger, like they're building up to this great, plan for, you know, other future movies. But they just jam-packed it so much, trying to force-feed it down our throats, that they were going to do so much more, that it completely ruined the film and killed the franchise. Like, it basically forced, you know, Sony to reboot Spider-Man with The Amazing Spider-Man. Loved the first one, then the second one, they did the same thing where they got overly ambitious. And they're kind of like, let's create our own, like, spider-connected universe! Ah, Sinister Six, Venom, and all this other shit! Ah! And then, like,
and then
it just...
And they got a lot of famous people in it, too. Like, that was the one where they got, what's his name? Jamie Foxx?
Yeah, Jamie Foxx. Like, they had a great cast. Like, Paul Giamatti, which, granted, he was underutilized as the Rhino. But even still, they had all these really good actors, and it was, again, it was just... And a lot of it was the studio. Like, Sony was like, okay, I get what you're doing here, I like it, but we need to force all this other stuff in here so that way we can let people know that we're building our own thing and it's going to be great. Like, I get that from a studio perspective. You know, you want to let people know that it's like, okay, here's stuff that's going to happen later that you'll be excited for. But the reason why it worked for Marvel is they... did it very slow and steadily, where they built up to the Avengers, and then after Avengers, they're like, okay, that did well, now let's do our sequels to our, you know, standalone characters, like our Thor, Captain America, Iron Man, and then we'll build up to,
and
like, another...
And then they get even more risky in making things that people have never even heard of, yeah. such as Guardians of the Galaxy and Ant-Man. And now they're doing more, like they're doing, what is it, Black Panther's another one they're doing?
Yeah, they're doing Black Panther, Doctor Strange, like some of these more obscure characters. But at this point, Marvel can do whatever the hell they want, and people are going to go see it, and they're going to love it.
Well, except for Fantastic Four as well.
Well, that wasn't Marvel, like Cinematic Studios. That's Fox that owns Fantastic Four. Because Fox apparently doesn't know how to make a Fantastic Four movie, but that's a whole nother thing.
But they know how to make X-Men movies, if I remember.
Yeah, they've gotten a lot better with X-Men. So I'm hoping that, like, again, DC, I hope they've just got a very specific plan. That's why they got these weird casting choices. And why...
Yeah, that's a big thing I've noticed is it seems like ever since they've released even so many minor bits of knowledge about it, it's just been a very controversial subject in films, yeah. such as the first thing is the fact that Christian Bale was being replaced by Ben Affleck. Well, granted, they couldn't do much because Bale did not want to return. But another thing that really caught me, and I've noticed some people are discussing, is the fact that Michael Caine is being replaced by Jeremy Irons.
Well, like, so I guess to clarify for some people who may not know this, but, like, the Nolan trilogy, that's its own separate thing. Like, it's not connected to Man of Steel or this, DC Cinematic Universe. Like, it's its own thing. So, like, the Ben Affleck Batman, it's not a recast, it's just, it's a recast, but it's not like
Zack Snyder and the public in general. They did want Christian Bale to come back for Batman versus Superman, yeah. just because he was so great at it. Even though some people said he was bad at it, just because I remember one of my friends compared Christian Bale to a stormtrooper. As when he's Bruce Wayne, he never has an expression on his face. I personally disagree. I thought he was fantastic, but it could just be just because I'm a huge fan of Christian Bale. But
yeah,
it is what it is.
Yeah, because I mean they. If he had wanted to return, I think they definitely could have tied then the Nolan trilogy to, you know, Man of Steel and like the cinematic universe. But
also, if that was the case, then maybe Christopher Nolan would have probably wanted to have a bigger part in it, maybe even direct it, because you know,
yeah.
he didn't want people to tamper with his trilogy.
And I think, I think that's a good idea. I think, like, they should just leave his trilogy of Batman films as is, because they're really good. Even if Dark Knight Rises wasn't as good as, like, Dark Knight or Batman Begins, it's still, I think it's the best film we could have gotten without.
It's still a good trilogy, and,
yeah.
It may be the worst in the series, but
it's still overall a solid film.
All good.
Yeah. So I think that's, I think that's great that they're leaving it as is, and they're just kind of sort of rebooting, but not really Batman again. I will say this, though. This is the most comic-accurate Batman costume we've ever seen. Because every other Batman costume in films, aside from the Adam West ones, have been solid black. Which, I love the Adam West ones for different reasons. The one that Ben Affleck is in is the most comic accurate, like the black and gray. So I love that. I love the fact that their costumes and everything look very comic accurate. I know that's a minor detail, but I like when they put the extra.
Well, sometimes minor details are the best details.
Exactly. Like, it just shows.
Especially because of how damn cool it looks. It looks more almost cyborg looking than, I guess, some of like the older ones, like the Michael Keaton Batman.
Yeah. They're
good films, but. But then again, it was the late 90s, or late 80s, early 90s, so yeah. I guess there wasn't a whole lot they could do, but it definitely does look downright cool.
Oh yeah, and
also, it also seems to borrow parts from the game Batman Arkham Knight, which if you're not playing, it is a fantastic game.
I'm probably going to get a lot of hate. I've never played any of the Arkham games. Like, I've heard nothing but good things.
A sniper outside your window with a laser pointing at you.
Probably. They're just kind of like, what? Feel free to give me hate. I'll play them eventually. It's just I'm not much of a gamer. But that's neither here nor there.
That's kind
of
true.
So, I mean, again, there's a lot of things that I like about what's going into this whole Batman versus Superman movie, because there are a lot of scenes, especially from that first trailer, where it looks like they ripped it straight out of Frank Miller's Dark Knight Returns, the whole confrontation with Batman and his mech suit against Superman. And so I do think that, like, the fights between those two will be awesome, even if the movie sucks, which, again, let's hope that it doesn't. I want this movie to succeed for so many different reasons.
Or maybe if it even doesn't, even if it doesn't do terrific like, say, the Avengers, it could at least, I guess, get decent opinions and reviews. But definitely the one thing we all know it'll succeed at is the box office.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Like, even if this movie, like, story-wise and whatever, like, critically is just god-awful, it's gonna kill box office-wise. Like, for money yes. alone, they'll definitely keep the DC universe going.
Yes, like, opening weekend, it'll... Hell, it might even make the budget back. The only way I can see that it will not kill is after opening weekend, if it does so bad, people just slam it and say, do not go see this film. But that's very unlikely, but
yeah,
what the hell do we know?
So again, I feel like even if the movie is like isn't very good, I feel like the scenes with Batman and Superman fighting, it'll be worth it to where people will be like, hey man, you know, I just got done seeing Batman vs. Superman. It's like, oh, is it good? It's like, not really, but I would still go see it just for the fights with Batman and Superman. It makes it worthwhile. And
yeah,
so then
yeah,
there
that's
are people...
Kind of how, that's kind of how it was with, what's it called, with Man of Steel. It wasn't a storytelling one like the Dark Knight trilogy, but it was absolutely fun and entertaining to watch people literally get thrown through buildings and shit.
Yeah, it was like Dragon Ball Z, like the fight scenes, which, me being a Dragon Ball Z fan, I was just kind of like, yay! It can be done! They can make a Dragon Ball Z movie! And again, I know, there's a lot of criticism for Man of Steel, but I like the fact that they're addressing that, again, in this movie, where, yes, a lot of Metropolis was destroyed, and that's why, like, Bruce Wayne doesn't like Superman, he doesn't trust him, and even, like, some of the public, they're kind of like, did he save us? Like, did he really? I mean, sure, he defeated this other alien, but, like, I mean, look at Metropolis. A lot of people died, a lot of property damage, and I like the
yeah,
fact
actually,
that, like...
I think I remember a statistic I read. It was, like, cliche things. One of the things was buildings being destroyed, which is true. Look at Avengers, Captain America,
yeah.
Man of Steel, and I think, supposedly, if Metropolis was a wheel, was a real place that got destroyed, it was said that the damage done in that movie would have been somewhere between $100 and $800 billion.
Yeah. So, I mean...
That's a lot of money. Like, for fuck's sake, that would probably pay off a fraction of the national debt. So,
yeah.
Damn, so, he destroyed a lot of shit.
Yeah, and it's one of those things where I know a lot of people complain about it, but that's... I mean, come on, let's be realistic here. If, like, two superpowered beings on the level of Superman and Zod were actually fighting... They're not gonna just, like, I mean, Superman could have tried to lead Zod to, like, a barren area, like a desert or something, but Zod's smart. He knows Superman would have the advantage there, so he's not gonna just be like, yeah, okay, let's hold hands and frog to that little, you know, barren wasteland over there so we can duke it out like good old-fashioned gentlemen. No, Zod's gonna be like, okay, I have the advantage because I'm in this huge city. I can destroy the shit out of it all I want. Because it doesn't matter, I'm terraforming it. You, on the
yeah,
other hand...
Yeah, and also not to mention that Zod did not come there alone. He had a small army with him.
Yeah, because he had, like, three other Kryptonians, I believe. So, I mean, yeah, like, they're like, five in total superpowered beings going at it, so it's like, what do you expect? And again, this is Superman's first outing as a superhero. He can't be, like, the perfect Superman we know and love in the comics, even
yeah,
though...
exactly. So even if he did do it was so bad, he tried his best. You gotta
yeah.
give him that. It's like, imagine this. What if you were Superman? What the hell would have you done? Just pretty much flown over to the Bahamas and
yeah.
watched the city destructed.
And the fact that, like, people didn't like that he killed Zod. Again, what's he supposed to do? Slap him on the wrist and be like, stop it, Zod, you silly goose. Go to timeout.
Yeah.
No, it's like, okay, snap his neck or let him burn this family. I don't want to do this, but snap in the neck. And then that's where he gets this whole no-killing policy. I thought it made sense. I loved it. And so, I love the fact that they're addressing all that in this movie. Because, again, it makes sense. Like, in other superhero movies where, like, there's all this destruction, and, you know, the superhero, whoever maybe, defeats the bad guy. And, like, especially if there's, like, you know, people see him defeat the bad guy, they're like, yay! Which, you know, some people would be cheerful. Other people would be like, okay, yeah, he's dead. Who's gonna pay for the fact... Like, who's gonna pay for, like, my house? My house is gone. My car is blown to pieces. Or, you know, I lost family members or friends in the devastation of that fight. So I like the fact that they're bringing these kind of, like, realistic elements of, yeah, when super people, superpowered people fight in a big metropolitan city like that, there's not going to be, like, you know, no one's, yeah, people are going to get hurt, people are going to die, there's going to be a lot of damage. So, yeah. But we're going on about, like, 45 minutes, so I think we're going to wrap this up. Any closing statements, Tyler, before we close out this video?
I need to come back more often.
Alrighty. Again, like, he knows his films, so if you want
to... Yeah, and if any of you are curious, assuming Jake remembers to put my... Although I don't do much on my channel, it's TCM6420, and I don't upload a lot, but I do stuff here and there, so... I try.
He's
if you like me enough, then well, just hope I make another guest appearance on Mr. Jake's lovely channel.
Oh yeah, like, you know, we'll bring him in for some of our movie debates because he'd be a good contender since he knows films, directors, actors, and all that stuff pretty well. And if you all completely disagree with our opinions and hate us, feel free to leave your hateful comments below in the comment section, and I will enjoy that because your hate completes me. Or if you enjoyed it, like, comment, subscribe, share this with your friends, so that way they can know our opinions on things, because we're important, I guess, maybe? I don't know.
Yeah, and another statement I want to point out is, if either of you guys prepared to come to either of our houses with torches and pitchforks, because I don't read comics, or because Jake has not played a Batman game, we'll be ready for you motherfuckers.
I probably won't be ready, I'll probably just be, like, uploading a podcast, and then... You'll stab me. But, you know, whatever. That, you know, to each their own. If you want to come to my home and stab me or whatever, that's fine. I mean, it's not fine, but whatever. So, yeah. That wraps up this video. Hopefully you enjoyed. And until next time, everyone, cheers.